Hi, I'm John Campy of the Movie Blog, and this is my quick 3-minute review of the new Bourne Ultimatum. Now, before going into my thoughts on the Bourne Ultimatum, it should be, we should take a second here, and I'd like to give you my quick impressions and flashback of the second Bourne movie. I'll do that now. Ah, we're fighting! Oh, we're fighting! Ah, ah, you're punching me! You're punching me and it hurts so much! Oh my God! If we held the camera still and showed you this fight, it's so graphic and violent, the MPAA would certainly give us an NC-17. Ah, you're kicking me in the nuts and it hurts! That was the Bourne Supremacy. Now, having said that, going into the Bourne Ultimatum, I was a little bit skeptical, if you will. I liked the first Bourne Identity. I did. I liked it. The Bourne Supremacy, I didn't like as much as most people. I still thought it was a worthy motion picture, and I kind of enjoyed watching it, but I didn't really think it was special. I certainly not memorable, so I really didn't have a lot of hope going into the Bourne Ultimatum. Not to mention, every single one of the threequels this year have completely sucked. You know, Pirates, Spider-Man, Shrek. So I didn't know what to expect, and I am happy to report that somewhere along the lines, director Greengrass took some kind of sedative, or gave a sedative to his cameraman, and calmed them down, eased up on the epileptic seizures as, you know, they're trying to film a fight scene, and actually showed us the movie. Go figure. And you know what? I'm glad they did, because The Bourne Ultimatum is a damn good movie. It is exciting. It's pumped. We come across Jason Bourne, and, you know, he's so stubborn, he just can't get past the fact that they took his identity and killed his girlfriend. Let the past be the past. But at any rate, he's still upset about all this kind of stuff, still hunting down his identity and still trying to find who's ultimately responsible for the death of his girlfriend in the second film. And you know what? I was really afraid when you get into a part three like this, that you would hit a roadblock where they'd make the story just go right to hell and come up with all these weird types of plot twists and all these weird circumstances and plot devices. And you know what? This film very nicely avoided all those. It kept plowing straight ahead with its intent, straight ahead with its overall plot. The action is terrific. One of the bigger weaknesses I thought of the film was I found some characters unnecessary. Julia Stiles' character did apply some plot devices that were needed to move the story along, but it didn't need to be her, and it felt a little bit like a C-3PO was created by Darth Vader kind of moment, and if you've seen the film, you know what I'm talking about. So I didn't really think she was needed, but really, overall, the dialogue is sharp, the characters are good. Joan Allen was terrific in this film. She was great in a supporting role and gave a nice extra dimension to the overall film, and Matt Damon, he really is. I didn't buy him as a great action star in the first two ones, but you know what? I will now. He really sold me on this character, and I quite enjoy it. I am thrilled to say that this was a really solid, the first good threequel film of the year, and a little saddened to say that we aren't going to see another one, and that's too bad. On a scale of 1 to 10, I'm going to give The Bourne Ultimatum an 8.5 out of 10. On a scale of No Going Ralph, I'm going to give it a total Ralph. For the Movie Blog, I'm John Campia.